Good evening, everybody. I'm really sorry about the time that it took me to get going. Obviously, we were much later than anticipated. In Modern War, you will die like a dog for no good reason, Ernest Hemingway. So, as promised, we are going to be starting, maybe finishing, and we might actually break this up across a couple of different playthroughs. For this war of mine, I don't know exactly how long the game takes. I'm actually a little curious what some of these are, so let's just take a quick. Okay, don't need to worry about controls. The Babel Project is a community-based initiative that will allow to bring this war of mine experience to people around the world. Thanks to the effort of all participants, soon the game will be available in all major languages, allowing everyone to play in his native language. You can be a part of the project, register, and start working on the translation right away. It's a really good idea. I actually wish more games would do that. Now we've got some credits going on here. I'll give this a minute to run just so everybody can, we can move along. I figure if I start late, it would be nice to let people, it'd be nice to let people get a chance to move in. I know this is a game that a lot of people have been wanting to watch me play. I really wish I knew more about the Bosnian War, if I'm completely honest, which is not to say that I am completely ignorant of it. But I think, as I said last stream, the one thing I don't want to do is, rush out and do, a ton of research just so I can then turn around and say, "Oh, hey guys, look how smart I am. I'm able to Wikipedia the Siege of Sarajevo." That's a little. I mean, it's not to say, "Hey, T. Clark, good to see you again." We're just taking a little bit to warm up so everybody can come in. Although it looks like we've got some fairly good. Got some. Looks like everybody's sort of filing in, so I won't spend too much more on this. But yeah, so like the intention isn't to try and pretend I know things that I don't. Obviously, I do read a little bit of history, and I mean, this is history that we have. I don't know if I should say lived through, but it's. I mean, it's something that's occurred within most of our lifetimes. So. It's also not like, you can really afford to be completely, ignorant of the events or what this game is about. So I'll do my best to sort of mix between a little bit of reading that I've done and maybe some of the ideas that I can think of about this game from maybe a design perspective or from, the experience of playing the game. But how's it going, Ricky Guitarist? Good evening to you as well. Again, I apologize for being so late on getting started. I had a little bit of trouble heading home. I actually, before we jump into this really heavy game, one thing I will say is I tried. I do like board gaming, and it's been a very long time since I've tried BattleTech. Like, I remember. God, I don't even know the editions or something like that, but I remember, like, playing it on, like, a hex. Could be better. I'm sorry to hear that, Ricky Guitarist. Anything we can help you out with? I've been okay. I've been a little, lethargic. But I got a weekend coming up. Hopefully, I'll get some, productivity done. But yeah, so I like. Oh God, I don't know how long these credits are. This is maybe a mistake. I really wanted to play BattleTech for a while, especially because I kickstarted the Harebrained Schemes edition of it. Which will be coming out next year, I think. And I think they've got a 25th anniversary edition that's out or something like that. All right, well, I'm sorry to hear it nonetheless, Ricky Guitarist. Very warish night for you today. Just finished watching a documentary series about World War I not too long ago, and now this. Jesus, what are you doing to yourself, T. Clark? By the way, funny you should mention World War I. I still have more war games I'm going to go through. Jesse Quill, thank you so much for that host. Hi, be right back, though. I guess I'm not allowed to shout her out until she comes back. So anyways, I went to, I think, five different board games. So one, I didn't know there were five different board game stores in Vancouver. And then after, all of them failed to have a copy of Battletech. So I finally, at the last place, this is actually a really interesting thing about stores as well, is none of these offered to order it in, except for the very last one, which I was at. And it was actually a fairly good price too, so that should probably be there within a week. But it's so interesting because I would have basically said yes to any of the first stores that said, you know, we don't have it, but we can bring it in for you. And literally none of them offered. All right, I'm sorry, but as much as I want to give credit, this is going on a little long, so it's 7 minutes in. Now, I always wondered about this. This is the only one I've ever tried. Isn't this something that you unlock? I don't know. Anyways. Day one. How long has the siege lasted? It's hard to say when every day is a struggle for survival. The city is crawling with snipers. Shelling is ordinary business almost every night. Phones don't work. There's a shortage of food and meds, and many people are left homeless. Bruno and Marco have always been good friends, so when the war broke out, they decided to stick together. They met Pavel while scavenging for supplies. He used to be Pogorin's star football player. Now he's just another homeless victim of war, so they teamed up, hoping for the best. So, this game is a little time sensitive, so I'm just going to make sure that whenever I'm talking, I'm going to go to one of these more, to one of these pause menus or something like that. But it's not bad to do some biography as well, because this game actually, it's able to adopt sort of a convention that's also used in XCOM, which is to create sort of a sense of connection with these characters. In the case of XCOM, it's usually the fact that, you know, you've put so much into building up this character and you know, getting them through missions so that when you lose them, it feels quite painful. In the case of this story, you know, you have only three characters and you learn a bit of their biography. I think that's how the attachment is created in this game. So we've got Pavel. Before this whole mess began, I lived with my wife and son in a better part of the city. I haven't seen them in a long time. I hope they're okay. I'm not doing so well, as you can see. Who needs football players during the war? Nobody cares about sports when every day can be their last. So I scavenge the ruins like everyone else, hoping for the best. And as a sports player, each of these characters will have a special trait. So in this case, Pavel is a fast runner. Bruno, on the other hand, is a good cook and a smoker, which is in this case a negative trait because it's not easy to find cigarettes in a war zone. Before the war, I used to own a restaurant. I even had my own TV show, Bruno's Cuisine. I'm sure you've seen it. I visited beautiful places where I was filmed cooking exquisite dishes. All that seems of no importance now, don't you think? Nowadays, you're lucky if you can get your hands on some canned meat or a bag of rice. And who knows how long this war is going to last. And finally, we've got Marco, who's a skilled scavenger. I thought I'd been through hell before. I'm a fireman. I've entered blazing buildings to save lives more times than I care to remember. But back then, I had people teamed up against a common foe, namely the fire. Nowadays, your former neighbor can kill you because your grandparents spoke a different language than his. This is true hell on Earth. So maybe this is actually the first point where we talk a little bit about the context for this game. This is sort of based on a real-life event. It was the Siege of Sarajevo, which has the dubious distinction of being the longest siege in modern warfare. It lasted almost 3 years, I think. I'm not so clear on the dates, if I'm completely honest. And so, what I'm just doing here is I'm going through whatever rubble I can manage to get items. But in this case here, it was the former Yugoslavia, which had kind of three major ethnic groups. Now this is where I'm probably gonna get a few things wrong. So I think it was the I think it's the Bosniaks are the Muslim group. They were the not the majority, but the largest group. There were these Serbs, which were Orthodox, and there's the Croats, who were Catholic. And this is actually the Bosnian War was where the term ethnic cleansing came out, and the idea. Hey, Gunny Steiner, thank you very much for that follow. So the idea here is, you are attempting to drive out either through intimidation or through, you know, really any kind of means that you can. And this does mean also murder, but effectively to try and drive out people of a different ethnicity than you. And in this case, the majority of atrocities committed in this conflict were on the Serbian side, including things such as mass rape of the Bosniaks. I really apologize. I wish I had these names down properly. So, in the case of the Siege of Sarajevo, the effort here was to basically, I mean, it was a very deliberate attempt to create pretty close. Out of curiosity, you looked it up. It lasted from April 5th, 1992 to the February 29th, 1996. My guess is better than mine, long. But effectively, the aim was about as horrifying as you can imagine. It was to try and sort of inflict as much sort of damage as possible on the sort of the civilian populace to try and make them fall into the demands of the besiegers. And so that's where this game picks up. It doesn't specifically say that this is Sarajevo, but basically that is the inspiration for this particular game. And I think the real brilliance behind this is, you know, crafting and survival has, you know, it's been a part of it's been a part of gaming for a really long time now, but it's been usually in the form of, you know, oh, what would you do in the zombie apocalypse? You know, I would be, you know, awesome, you know, once we remove any, you know, any sense of civilization or something like that, we'll get away with everything, we'll be, you know, we'll live like kings or what have you. And what this game does instead is it deals with something that's actually a very unfortunate reality for a lot of people, which is their, you know, crafting and survival is not a fictional, you know, event. You don't need to worry about some made-up opponent like a zombie. In this case, it was people who, you know, previously had been integrated together. I mean, the history of this region was originally under the Ottoman Empire, and then it was under the Soviet Union. And so I should have built a stove. Oh, that's not a stove, that's a heater. So I need wood and electronics, which I can probably get if I make a crowbar, but I'm gonna switch it out and get the people resting. And I screwed myself. So we've got all that we can right now. But I'm gonna just take a chance to talk a little bit about the game and set it up. So, you know, in this game, you have... So again, in this region, you've got sort of a combination of different ethnic groups, which had previously coexisted. And then there was a sort of a call for independence, which was recognized by... Hey, CPO Williams, good to see you again. It was recognized by the international community. But unfortunately, basically, it turned to a point where these different groups wanted to basically have sort of exclusive zones for each of these, you know, for their particular faction, for their particular group. And so as a result, you saw this terrible conflict, possibly one of the worst in Europe since World War II, sort of come as a result of this. And as I said, you know, specifically this siege was not necessarily to, you know, try and take out some, you know, military installation or something like that. It was very specifically to inflict as much harm as possible so that people would give in to, you know, give in to the demands. So again, the real intelligence of this game is to, you know, take a convention that people are very familiar with, which is crafting and survival. This is a game that's, or this is a genre that is very well established. And what they've done instead is they've said, you know, there's no need to have this fantasy element. We can tell this story very directly. Oh, this is a tough call. We'll get Pavel to guard. You know, all that they say is, you know, let's not take war from the view of a... I really need that crowbar, actually. But that's fine. There's probably going to be more stuff than I can carry this first time around. The looters must have been in a hurry. There's still a lot of stuff left. So the advantage here of skilled scavengers is the most pack space for this character. So what I'm particularly interested in right now is to get as many crafting materials as I can get. I can't get everything in one go, so what I'm going to be doing here is I'm going to be picking up as much wood and sort of components and things like that. And I'll be leaving. Some of these other items might be more valuable, but what I want to do is sort of get myself set up for the next day. Yeah, as I sort of said in the introduction last time around, what studio made this game? This is by 11-Bit Studios, Gunny Steiner. I believe they made sort of this tower defense-ish sort of game, which I can't recall the name for at the moment. Oop, let's hit in there. Yeah, not a problem. Should actually let you know too, they've released two bits of DLC for this game, and they did a really interesting version. So the way that they did the first DLC for this game, it was purely cosmetic, and you could choose to pay more, and the surplus that you paid would actually go towards this War Child charity. You know, something tells me I'm gonna need some more of these components. So let's try this first. A family photo of parents and two daughters. Good thing the girls don't resemble their father. He looks like a bear. Oh, you know what? I'm gonna want the food too. I gotta drop the wood. Oh, it's Anomaly is what it's called. Anomaly was kind of fun. It's not exactly the sort of thing that I normally play, but it was definitely a fun ride. And then they've recently added another DLC, which used to be a PlayStation exclusive, I believe. But this is the one, it adds children to the game. I haven't really played the original game, so I didn't want to buy it. It's one that I'm sort of interested in. Ah, now this is the interesting thing, Ricky Guitarist. So this is, I was kind of hoping Elpoke would be here for this, but I don't mind repeating it. So from my understanding of this game is that it has a particular duration. It's sort of got a period of time under which the war won't end. And what happens after is there is a randomized ending. So there's going to be, just as there was in the Bosnian War, there will be a ceasefire declared between the different groups. And in the case of this game, what they've done is they've randomized the ending. Now, this interests me from a game theory perspective because this will take a little bit of setup. And sorry, T-Clark, I see what you've written here. I'll address it in a minute, but I'll get this ending idea out of the way just because it's come up. So most people are probably going to be familiar with something like the Prisoner's Dilemma in game theory or something like that. Actually, you know what? Maybe I'll just get the reading out of the way. So T-Clark says, one of the things you like about the crafting and planning is the planning required. You can't just go out and farm materials and then make everything you need in one go. Resources are limited. Carrying space is limited. Everything is limited in a very real ways. You have to choose wisely and you're going to build. You have to choose wisely what you're going to build and when you're going to build it. It says, a note that says, on the first day they robbed us. 2 days later they murdered our girls. I shot every one of them, but I don't want to use the gun anymore. It's broken and buried in the backyard. The next part looks shaky. If you're reading this, don't look for me. So, why am I rambling on about the Prisoner's Dilemma? It's probably just the most famous example of game theory. And so the idea here is that, you've got two people, sort of caught by the police, two criminals caught by the police. They can be sort of gotten on a lesser charge, but they don't quite have enough evidence to convict, and so they want to structure a situation under which they'll get a confession. And so the deal that they're offered is basically, this is probably the gun. So the deal basically goes, if you confess, your partner takes all of the blame and you get off scot-free, or, with a trivial kind of, I found plenty of really fine stuff. What a night. So Marco has been searching for supplies and brought home some interesting things, and the night was calm. So I'll just hold off on doing some activity for a little bit just so I can get this idea out of the way. And I will be answering your is there an ending to this game. So, you can get off on a minor charge or basically scot-free if you sell out your partner. You can remain silent and you will suffer a minor charge that you've been brought in on, but not the crime. And then of course, if you both confess, then you're both going to get hit. Hey, Dad. And Jessiquil, how are you? Well, Dad, you get to hear how much I like your daughter. Because guys, did you know that Jessiquil is a caster on Twitch TV, and she's taken on responsibility of being a mod, and so I'm going to embarrass her by asking that she do a shout out for herself. I would like to take a quick minute. I'm gonna stop rambling about game theory. It's good though. It's a very smart thing that they've done for ending this game. So I do want to go through it, even if it's lengthy. But I do want to take a minute and say Jessiquil is a very dear friend of mine, as I like to call her, one of my stream moms. She was one of the first people who I kind of got to know on Team Panda, originally as one of Seriously Clara's mods, somebody who was very encouraging. I would often try and write things on Clara's forums, and I would... not always get the best responses, but Jess always made an effort to try and make sure that I was included. And then the time came to apply for Team Panda, and I also asked her for a little bit of advice about streaming, and she's one of the people who gave me some of the advice that I've taken with me to this day, which is just keep talking. You have a nice voice, so keep using it. And occasionally I say something smart. Hey, Elpoke. Actually, I was just about to start the game theory thing, so you got... you came in right on time. These are things that have stayed with me, and time has gone on. I've gotten the opportunity to mod for her. We've become very good friends. I always like to say she's the heart to my head, because even though I talk a lot about a lot of... you like her a lot too? I'm very happy to hear that. I think I get too much credit for talking about the highfalutin stuff, but if you watch Jess's stream, she is a very deeply caring person, somebody who really understands people, how they operate, you know, what they need to hear to become the best person that they can. She has got, reservoirs of empathy that I'm certainly not capable of having. And she talks about things that I think matter a little bit more. Like, you know, I can ramble on about game theory and stuff like that, but in the end, you know, it doesn't mean as much when Jessiquil, you know, is able to deal with things that maybe speak in a truer sense to, you know, to people. And this is actually one of the things I'll say that makes this war of mine so interesting. I have decided to do a war week, and I think one of the things that... Well, not a week, but like, you know, a series on war on Twitch. And I think in the end, the reason why people are interested in this is there is a question, you know, why do people take up arms? You know, why do people do this to each other? There's also the question, you know... Again, these groups were able to live together under the Soviet Union. They were able to live together under the, under the Ottoman Empire. What was it that caused this to become so, you know, so violent? What was it that actually caused the ethnic cleansing? And in the end, I think that's, you know, indirectly, it's actually when I do these sorts of things in my own studies. So for instance, I did the study on the response in Pakistan, basically support for insurgents in response to the US drone program. The big driver for me was to focus on the individual, to focus on, you know, the person. You can't just say, you know, I'm going to take some aggregate statistic about a nation and say, you know, this nation went to war with this nation and it's because commodity prices went down or something like that. It's a very personal, it's a very individual thing. And so that's one of the reasons why I really like going to Jesse Quill's channel, and why I really like interacting with her, why I really like watching her stuff, because she is one of those people who never forgets about the individual. She's always able to bring that empathy and bring that that personality to bear on it. So, love Game Theory. Keep it going. Yeah, sorry guys, I gotta focus. Anyways, guys, I know Jesse Quill gets a lot of shoutouts here, but it is absolutely. Oh, come on, no, get back to sleep. Do not let familiarity breed contempt. She is a wonderful human being. I am very privileged to call her a friend. And if you have not watched her cast, you are missing out. You definitely need to. You need to do yourself the favor and check it out. So while we're clearing the rubble, I'll get back to this. So again, the canonical example of Game Theory is usually the prisoner's dilemma. So you know, you can both stay silent, and you'll be given some minor charge. You can confess, at which point your partner takes the fall, and you get off scot-free. And of course, if you both confess, then you both get hit with the maximum penalty. And what makes this interesting is that in Game Theory, you'll check out our channel, you've hyped her up more than Watch Dogs, so you're looking forward to it. Awesome. Thank you, Ricky Guitarist. So the big thing about Game Theory is that individuals are going to, they're going to do what they prefer. You can say it's, you know, people are selfish, people are assholes, or whatever. You know, I would prefer not to make that, you know, that call. You guys can decide that for yourselves. But they are going to seek the best outcome. And in the case of the prisoner's dilemma, it's pretty clear that you, that they're in this situation, we have structured people's preferences such that they are going to want to, you know, suffer the smallest penalty possible. And so because people are going to seek out the best outcome for themselves, they are there's only one conclusion, which is both people are going to confess. And the reason for this is that, you know, the same offer is given to the other guy. And so, you know, what's the best outcome for the both of us? Well, if we both stay silent. But if we do that, I have a better opportunity, which is to basically rat out my partner, and I suffer no jail time. Ah, damn it, I don't have vegetables. Do I hold out to dry and get? I don't think I get more. I don't think there's more vegetables in that ruin. Anyways, I'm just going to hold on this menu for a little bit so I can finish this example. So the idea here is that while it may be, it may be, you know, the smallest total jail time is given if we both stay silent. Me as an individual, if I know that my partner is staying silent, then I can do something better for myself, which is to rat out my partner, and then I don't have to suffer any jail time. Of course, they know that I'm going to do this as well, and as a result, both of us wind up ratting out the other guy. We both confess. And in this case, there's no... that's an equilibrium. That's the only equilibrium of the game. And so as a result, we, you know, we have to suffer this, you know, this worst possible outcome, because the incentives are structured to, so throughout, the prisoners can't talk to each other, right? That is correct. Yeah. So the way that you do this is you say, you know what, just give me a second here. This is going to be a little bit easier to do an MS Paint. So let's do a Game Theory interlude. In the end, this is going to relate to the way that they have structured the... this is going to relate to the way that they've structured the ending of this War of Mine. But
Seeing as there's a bit of interest in this, I don't mind taking a minute. Oh God, I'm on Windows 10, so I don't know how to find MS Paint anymore. How do you use this computer again? Oh my God, this is awful. There we go. Thank you, Jess. All right. Good enough. All right, isn't this exciting, chat? Let's just get some music on in the background. Oh, come on. Sorry, guys. I won't spend too much time on this, but did we go over the canvas with liquid white already? Okay, so I'm gonna do a payoff matrix here. Let me know if the music is too loud. Music's too loud? Okay. Hopefully that'll fix it. All right. So all that I'm doing here is getting a payoff matrix. Actually, let me just try something a little different. Is there no volume?
Using computers to create weird random patterns.
All right. Ulpok says you were in an ethics class. You did an example of the prisoner's dilemma. We actually got to play it out, but you screwed over your partner because you knew exactly what your logical choice should be in this example, and he didn't. He was like, "So we're going to do what's best for us as a duo, right?" And you're like, "Yeah." Then you screwed him over because you knew what he was picking. All right. Well, even if you do talk to each other, it's actually possible to. It's depending on what you do. Okay, so let's. So we've got player two. Okay. So what we're going to do here is we're going to fill each of these boxes with the payouts. And so basically, the left-hand side is going to be the payoff for player one. Actually, I'm going to do that in red. And then player two is going to be in blue. Okay. So let's say that if we both stay silent, we get hit with a penalty of one. So if I confess and my partner doesn't, then. You know what? Should make this. Oh, actually, no. I can still work this out. If I confess, I get a two. and then I get a zero.
It's interesting to me.
If I get all right, so let's just see exactly how this works.
Right.
Professor, let you talk to each other, but you get that even if we're able to talk to each other, we still get to the same equilibrium. Sure, but Logan, this is for the benefit of the whole chat, though, right? So the idea here is that if I don't say anything, and we both don't say anything, then we get hit with some lesser charge. So it's better than nothing, but it's still not as good as if I get off scot-free. So higher is better, okay? So in this case, if I stay quiet, I get hit on the lesser charge. If I confess, I get, I wind up with my best payoff. Now, if the other guy rats me out, then I take the fall. If I stay mum, I get a zero. Actually, hang on a second. I'm gonna be back in a second. I think I might have set this up wrong. Sorry guys, this is actually a really easy example, but I always do it in negatives. I'm gonna rewrite this in negatives just so I can keep it straight in my head. Alright, sorry guys, so let's redo this. So what I'm going to do instead is I'm going to go for negative numbers for however long I go. So let's say that I have to suffer one year in jail if we both stay quiet. If I take the fall, then I have to go 3 years in jail, okay? Now, if my partner stays quiet and I confess, I don't spend any time in jail. And then if we both confess, let's say, I don't know, we do like 2 years in jail. Like we get some compensation for like cooperating, but we still get hit with a pretty heavy fine, right? So now we're gonna work out the payoffs for the other guy. And they should be the exact same, right? So in this situation here, we've got both of us staying quiet. It's gonna be the exact same payoff for both of these guys, right? So player two is gonna get a negative one for staying silent. Now, in this case, they've confessed and player one has stayed silent. So in this case, they spend no time in jail. All right? Now, in this case, they've stayed silent while I've confessed, which means that we're going to get sort of the inverse of this. And so they wind up spending 3 years in jail. And then finally, we sort of said that there's going to be symmetry in these cases where we do the same action. And so they also spend 2 years in jail. Okay? So, I mean, in the end, all that I've done here is I've just added a little bit more clarity in terms of the numbers. I don't like, you know, saying it's like, okay, you're going into jail, but like the higher value is better or worse. So the idea here is what we've done is we've worked out these, we've come up with a numerical representation of each of these decisions. Now, what we can do here is we can find out what the best strategy is. And what we could do is we could eliminate dominated strategies. So let's say that we're player one, and I'm considering, okay, do I stay mum or do I confess? Well, what happens if I stay mum? Okay, well, if I stay mum, there's one of two possibilities. Player two is also going to stay mum, and we both suffer a negative one, negative one. Or the other guy can confess, and I get a negative 3. All right. Now, there's a, I don't necessarily know what this other player is going to do. So what we're going to do is we're going to take the perspective of player 2 and say that, let's say they knew with certainty that I was going to stay mum. What would they do? Well, in this case, player 2 looks at their possibilities. We've said, with certainty, I'm going to stay mum. And so they're going to say, okay, well, I can get a negative 1 payoff or I can get a 0 payoff. Well, it doesn't make any sense for me to stay mum. I can get a better payoff for myself by confessing. And so I would not want to do this. All right? So when I'm player 1, I know that if I stay mum, player 2 is going to confess. So what happens if I decide to confess instead? Well, again, player 2 can stay mum or they can confess. And so we'll do the same exercise. We can say with certainty they know that I'm going to confess. What are they facing? Well, they can get a negative 3 or they can get a negative 2. Well, nobody's going to choose the worse option. And so in this case, they eliminate staying mum, and they say they're going to confess in this scenario because they want to get the lesser of the two penalties. Now notice in both of these scenarios, they don't want to stay mum, okay? So I know that player 2 in either of these situations is going to confess. The other thing that I could have done was observe that I've got a negative 1, negative 3, and I've got a 0 and a negative 2. This is a dominated strategy for player 2 because in each of these situations, their payoff is worse. And unambiguously worse. If these were the same, if this was a negative two and this was a negative 2, then I wouldn't be able to eliminate stay mum. But in this situation too, it's always the worse option to stay mum. And we can do the same exercise for player 2 thinking about player 1, right? But what we're going to do is we're going to observe that, well, it's negative 1 if they stay mum versus 0 and negative 3 versus negative 2. Again, we've got a dominated strategy here. So we eliminate this and we eliminate this. And this is the only equilibrium point, all right? So even if you are, even if you're collaborating with your partner, your best outcome is still going to come from confess, because you have an incentive to deviate. Now, the reason this doesn't necessarily happen in the real world all the time is because, I have imposed this assumption that I prefer the confess equilibrium to, confess stay mum or something like that. I've already assigned a value to these, and it could be that maybe you value loyalty more than I do in this construction. This is the prisoner's dilemma, yes, Cypher C. Then there are some other examples where if you do an infinitely repeated game, you may not necessarily have the same outcome. But this was just to give you an example. I hope everybody's sort of clear on how this particular example works, right? Does anybody have any questions in terms of how the confess equilibrium is the only outcome of this game, given the fact that we've said that these are rational players and they want to get the best outcome that they can? I'm going to go back to the game if that's the case. Okay, great. This war of mine, I would love to start playing you again. Sorry guys, that's what I get for doing a little... Alright, you know what? Time for Control-Alt-Delete. Okay, so one question that you might say is, okay, so what are some situations in which we may not see this equilibrium that we worked out? And one really good example of this would be a repeated game, or at least in principle, this could be something that changes it. So let's say that we played, we can see that staying mum is kind of the smallest total amount of prison time. And so you might say, what is there maybe a way that we could structure this game so that we have an excuse to, am I really not able to get back into this war of mine? That's really upsetting if... Okay, guys, I'm going to have to crash out of this war of mine, it looks like. But that's fine, we didn't get too far in the game, so... So you could say, well, what if we wind up repeating the game? We say it's like, okay, you know what? I'm going to, you know, we're going to play this game a few times over. And if you screw me, then I'm going to go out of my way to, you know, I'm going to go out of my way to make sure that you get the worst possible outcome. And so if that's what you set up, it seems like it works. Like, let's say that, you know, for 9 days, we decide to play that way. The drawback is on the 10th day, we don't have any, we know that it's going to, you know, we know that it's going to be over. And so in that situation, we still wind up, you know, in the last period, we know that we're going to betray each other. And of course, this is the catch, is that because we know we're going to betray each other on the 10th day, we're going to do that on the 9th day, and the game unravels again. But where it becomes interesting, and where there's a possibility of some kind of arrangement being made, and this is not necessarily just the prisoner's dilemma, this can be a few different cases, but if you have this idea of an infinitely repeated game, so if you continuously redo... If you repeatedly do the game, and this goes on forever, it's actually possible that you will. It's possible that you. You know, you can get an equilibrium in which people kind of collaborate, and again, this is either, you know, they know the rules of the game and they see that this is an optimal strategy, or they talk to each other. There's a few different ways that you can motivate it. But then you ask the question, well, is there an example of, hey, Jewish Bagel, I do remember you. I'm so happy you decided to stop by again. When you think about an infinitely repeated game, you know, obviously we have finite, lifespans. And so it seems like something that might just be a theoretical abstraction. Oop, that's not what I wanted. Go back to sleep. But as it happens, actually, this is a great little trick that you can do in experimental economics. If you want people to behave as if it's an infinitely repeated game, all that you really need to do is randomize the ending. Have a great night, Gunny Steiner. I'm sorry I took so long to get through the game theory. I hope this is at least slightly interesting for you. I'll have a big payoff in a quick second. but so this idea here where you wind up doing an infinitely repeated game, if you randomize the ending, people are going to behave as if it basically goes on forever. And so what this game has done by randomizing the end of the war... what they've done is you treat it as if this war is going to go on forever. The game only lasts something like 20 or 30 days, I think. But you are going to treat it like it was a multi-year siege, precisely because you don't know that, you know, on day 23, you wind up, you know, it's like, okay, if I make it to day 23, I can, like, consume all of my food because I know the game's going to end at that point. You don't know when the ceasefire is going to come. And so the brilliance of this game is to give you some credibility in terms of this, again, the longest siege in modern military history. they've structured the game in such a way that you are going to behave as if the game goes on forever. So this is a very, very long way of answering that question. You know, is this game about lasting as long as you can? Absolutely it is. But in this sense here, there is a very clear, well, I shouldn't say a very clear ending. There is a definite end to the game, but you don't know when it ends. Just like the people inside a city under siege for multiple years are not going to know when the ceasefire arrives. Exactly. It's not perfect RNG, so there's no possibility of the siege being lifted on day three. But the game does randomize the ending, and I whether or not this is a conscious decision, whether or not, you know, they took a game theory course and they, you know, they knew what they were doing by setting it up that way, it is actually, there's a fairly sound game theoretic principle at work, you know, saying that this is a way that you can really make people live a multi-year siege. Ah, Gunny Steiner, we're gonna have to talk. I'm an economics major, so I've done far more game theory than I want to confess. You know what? Jess can tell you all about it. It's like Thanksgiving dinner. You can sit around the table. You can talk about, you know, mixed strategy equilibria. Yes, I foresee. I mean, I liked, I wanted to motivate it with the prisoner's dilemma because this is something that people are very familiar with. But certainly game theory is more than the prisoner's dilemma. It's a very, oh no, don't. It's a very, very rich, very interesting, intellectual endeavor. I think so. I mean, I'm an econ major. I have to. I have to say that. And actually one of my referees is my micro prof, so. You think you're gonna try and take a game theory course this coming semester if it's available? What year is it? I was a little inefficient in how I did the day. Obviously everybody's gonna be leaving hungry. But I'm getting a little bit of building and such done. What I'm doing here with Pavel is a very small chance that he will recover by sleeping. But in this case here, like, there's no, you know, there's nothing I have for him to do, so. Well explained, it was like tantric sex for your brain. Damn, that's high praise. One you would take is a 300 level course, but let you check that to confirm. Sure thing. I think we're gonna go back to the abandoned cottage. In this case, we've already got some food. Hopefully we don't get, hopefully don't get raided. In this case, we're gonna guard, and Marco is gonna scavenge again. What we're gonna do is we're gonna take the crowbar with us so that we can go to the abandoned cottage. It's actually a side of me that says that both of them should be up and guarding, and then we can just take turns sleeping. I'm going to try this as a strategy. Oh, I got an achievement. Is game theory heavily mathematical in more advanced cases, like basic logic versus logic used in digital circuits? Yeah, so, I mean, if you want to do game theory as I understand it, it's going to be a lot of mathematics. Now, I mean, again, I think if you want to understand the fundamentals, it's going to be a little bit more, going to be a little more proofs-oriented. It's going to be a little bit more about, say, you know, knowing some set theory, but my personal view is that if you want to get good at econ stuff, there really is no maximum amount of math to know. But with that in mind, right, like, it's important to have good intuitions, it's important to have good ideas. It's not that you know, you become a robot and just unthinkingly plug in a bunch of formulas or something like that. There's always going to be a place for people bringing insight and bringing fresh ideas into the structure of these problems. There's a fiscal policy course that looks interesting as well. Feeling like a guidance counselor now. Hey, melee mage! Alright, we already went in here. My craft is really different. But yeah, I mean, how do I put that? I mean, I don't want to sound elitist about this stuff too, but just can tell you though, I inevitably wind up being an elitist. I think, I guess the big thing about it is that math should just be a very formal set of tools to, you know, to give you sense, to give you guidance in terms of how you should be thinking about these issues. Sucks all of your courses are only worth 3 credits. It means you're going to take longer to get your bachelor's. Well, I mean, as long as you find it interesting, right? I really love the music for this game, by the way. Let's ditch a little bit of the wood. So yeah, the mathematics should be a set of tools for thought, and they ultimately guide your intuitions to a satisfying conclusion. There's definitely a side of, you know, of economics, or any people who study mathematics, I'll term it masturbation. There's a certain point where people just, you know, want to show off all the math they've studied for the sake of showing it off. And I think, I don't know, I think at that point it's an effort to alienate people from a conversation rather than, you know, sort of celebrate this this very interesting subject. So, still don't know how and when to use your more advanced courses like Calc 3 and Differential Equations. Your understanding it ended at Calc 2. I mean, to me, the majority of what I use from Calc 3 is just, you know, being able to do integration and mostly differentiation on problems with more than one variable. When is Miss Ariella going to be streaming next? You'd like to say hi and hang out for a while. That's a very good question, Jewish Bagel. I'm not too sure myself. She has been streaming fairly regularly. See, linear algebra is actually extremely useful, Cypher Steve, but I can see why that would be a hard course the first time around. Ah, damn it! We had 2 people and we got raided. We were attacked at night. Someone tried to rob us. There were just a couple of scavengers, so we managed to fend them off. Too bad we had no weapons. None of us were wounded, and the attackers didn't steal anything. We were able to defend ourselves. Excellent! Alright, so people need to get some rest. So the idea here is I think you can get 2 people, you can get basically 2 people rested in a day. In a sort of a day cycle. Kite, how are you doing? Starting off at 7:30 in the morning, I think both of these guys will finish sleeping. And I can get Pavel in bed and rested by the end of the day. Guys, hopefully Jess is still around so we can shout Kite out. But Kite is a great contributor to Team Panda. We have had some great chats. I'm gonna let him hang out for a little bit just so I can finish looting my home. He is a very talented caster. He has a wonderful personality, and I always like to say has mastered the co-op cast. Now, I haven't seen him co-op in a while. I think he was playing Smash most recently, if I'm not mistaken. But an absolute gem of a human being. Definitely recommend checking him out. Really friendly guy, and somebody who has been one of the most supportive members of several communities that I've been in. And this would be Seriously Clara's, this would be Jesse Quills, quite a few people who have had the benefit not only of his presence, but also his support, both as a viewer and a contributor and a subscriber. So he's a wonderful guy. I definitely recommend checking out his stream. And I think I have lost the m'lady. So let me just take a quick second here and shout you out myself. Computer, please, come on. I don't want to alt-tab because I lost the game. Am I going to let that guy stay with the group? Oh, I don't know if he's... I didn't know if he was... I thought he's just a traitor. Kite, I may... Actually, could I get somebody in chat to try shouting out Kite? Preferably somebody who's been here before or been here a while, so the bot might pick you up as a regular. Because it looks like my laptop doesn't want to connect to my router. It would just be exclamation mark SO Kite260. Is that still not working for you, T. Clark? That's embarrassing. I'm really sorry about that. Logan? Maybe the bot's not. Oh, it worked for one of you. Oh my god, so Kite was able to shout himself out. I am so sorry, guys. Okay, Logan and T. Clark, I'm going to get that fixed up. All right, I'm sorry about that, guys. I think I should just, like, do a normal... Oh, that's the attitude you're going to take. All right, let's see what we've got here. So, canned food is pretty tempting. So are materials, though. I really like this game, Kite. I'm not really comfortable with the idea of giving up these books for the wood. Is there anything else I can screw him out for? Hey, Dampy. What is my favorite econ sim game? That's a really good question. I don't know if I really have one. You know what? I'm going to say not interested for now. I'll regret my decision later. You definitely need to meet with a counselor to see what classes are going to be available in the fall, because you know they throw some up there later. I mean, so game theory will be an interesting and I think a worthwhile one for you to take. I think I'm going to upgrade my workshop. Okay, I think it's also time for us to make some food. Unfortunately, I don't have any vegetables, so I'm going to have to... Well, you know what? Maybe I can try a knife and... Okay, let's see what we can do here. So a herbal garden is going to cost me components and wood. Trap for small animals going to need... Okay. Let's make three of these. I did complete L.A. Noire. I quite liked it. Oh, I don't have enough for an... Oh, okay, I gotta go back. To work. A path of exile, is it? I believe Elpoke is also an econ major. There's a side of me that says I should just I should cook everything and God, that's such a hard decision actually, because I may like miss out on my garden and stuff like that. Has a trade system where currency is usable for modifying gear. Neat. Okay, what does it cost to upgrade this thing? Oh, I have enough. More efficient stoves allows us to prepare cooked food more efficiently, saving fuel. Oh god, that would be so good, except it's so expensive too. So let's hold off on that for now. All right, so let's think a little bit about what our next few steps are going to be. To become self-sufficient, I need food, so a trap for small animals. So I'm going to need 5 wood, 10 whatever components. So 5, 10, 10. 30, wow. Okay. So 35 wood. Forty components. 12. So I really need to be conserving all of this. I mean, there's also a side of me that says I should just build this rainwater collector, but I've actually got a very big stash of water right now, so. Yeah, econ is a bunch of BS, Elfolk. So you've decided on a master's already? Oh, and hey, Kale Bandit, I don't think I said hi to you yet. So this is going to be a little boring for a while, just while I see what's happening with Pavel. I'd be really interested to see if he loses tired, but... Okay, what I'll definitely recommend then, Logan, is it is impossible for you to know too little math. If you can, getting a good grade and a real analysis course will help a lot,
but don't take it. Okay, I gotta let him sleep. Like, don't take it just for the sake of, like, if you take it and you don't do well, then that's probably worse. This is really tough. So, I mean, this is tempting, and it doesn't say that it's dangerous. I think let's do the abandoned cottage because we know that we can get weapon stuff. Everybody's depressing me with their stories of their majors. At this point, I'm just going to start grabbing everything, and then I'll prioritize materials if I don't have enough. Jewish Bagel, I don't even own Minecraft. This is just a reference to the fact that this game has taken survival and crafting and done an entirely new spin on it. I definitely have not been playing Minecraft. So, Kite, I'm actually curious, have you played this game yourself? Or anybody, for that matter? I know there's some fans of the game in here, but I'd definitely be interested to know who's familiar with it, who's interested in it. Do you have any questions? Does anybody know about the Bosnian War? Hey, Cherny Michaela, good to see you again. Yeah, this is a really great game. You've seen Yip play it a lot. Oh, we still don't have enough space. All right, let's... Bandages are really tempting to get, but... So is the medicine, actually. I haven't played it yet because it's too dark in a real way. Yeah, I can definitely see people being... uncomfortable with the material. Okay, let's ditch the bears. We definitely need all these components. Bubble, you've been planning on getting this game, but you're not sure if your computer can handle it. Is it easy to handle? Let me just take a quick second to bring it up in Steam. I mean, this can be played on tablet, so I don't think it's very bad. Hey, Mixblit. From the Steam page, I'm going to assume you're on a Windows machine. The minimum system requirements would be Windows XP with Service Pack 3. Core 2 Duo 2.4 or an AMD Athlon X2 2.8, 2 GB of RAM, GeForce 9600 GS Radeon HD 4000 Shader Model 3 512 MB. So basically, like I'd say a fairly standard video card. Recommended Windows 7, Windows 8, Intel Core 2 Quad 2.7 GHz. So basically, if you've got a 3 GHz processor, 4 GB of RAM, and any modern, or not even that modern. Video card, I think you'll be fine. I don't know what lag I'm supposed to fix. So far as I can tell, it's not coming from my end. Sorry you're experiencing it, though. Decisions. I'm gonna need the fertilizer because I want to build this
this garden. Let's ditch the gunpowder. We don't actually need that yet. Okay, so we've got a bear gunpowder. This would be good to get. Yeah, we don't need shell casings if we're not taking gunpowder, so... If only your monitor was 1 millisecond refresh, it would be a pro stream viewer. Now you know what game you're buying now for sure. This game always seemed fun and exciting, always had you on edge, on your seat. You love, yeah, it's really good. Op Bubble 513. If I may recommend as well, I believe they have made a special edition for the Humble Store. And of course, you can, in addition to that, if you buy it from the Humble Store, a fraction of your purchase will also go towards a charity, and you can now decide what charity that will go to. So for instance, when I buy something from the Humble Store, I give it to Médecins Sans Frontières, Doctors Without Borders. And so if you would like, I mean, this developer, 11-bit, already has made some contributions to a charity known as War Child, but if the humanitarian aspects of this game and this, you know, this style works for you, I would say that the fact that there's a special edition allows you to get something a little bit extra, in addition to the fact that that money's not necessarily going into Gabe Newell's pocket, it's going into the pocket of an organization that I think is very worthwhile. So I hope you really enjoy it, Op Bubble 513. I like it, and I haven't spent a lot of time with it, actually. This is kind of my first major playthrough of the game. But I really want to see... I love supporting games like this, because, as I say, you know, for my own studies, I do a lot of work on political economy. My undergraduate thesis was about the response of citizens to... Oh, thank you so much for that follow. For support for insurgent groups in Pakistan in response to the U.S. drone program. I think, you know, conflict is best studied when focusing on the individual. And I think this is a nice... See, this is actually what we're talking about with Spec Ops The Line as well. This is a game which is about something. It is a very, you know, it is a very well done game. It is a well thought out, and it is a fun game to play on its own. I'm never a big fan when people try to add some gravitas to their reviews and say, you know, this game isn't fun to experience, but you need to. Like, this is actually a fun game to play. There is a challenge behind it, and it's very satisfying to go through the events and try and do as best as you can. But this is about an event that has occurred within most of our lifetimes. That maybe some people don't know happened, maybe some people don't quite appreciate the experience. Unfortunately, this is this, you know, we play a lot of games about soldiers, but in the end, the experience of war has been like this. You know, being a frightened civilian, not really sure about what the next day is going to hold, rather than being able to assert some small level of control over events. As you are when you know, when you're a soldier. So, I think they made a lot of very good decisions in making this game, and it's very satisfying to play, in addition to the fact that it gets you thinking and it gets you, you know, having an experience. So, and how's it going, 1-4? If you can give me a sec, by the way, Logan, I was meaning to give you some recommendations for text, but guys, if you can give me a second, I am absolutely parched, so I'm just going to take a very quick break. I'm just going to grab some water for myself, and then we'll be back to finish off the playthrough. Mm-hmm.
All right. Thanks, guys. So, Logan, if you're interested in game theory, a couple of these are going to be a little advanced, but I don't necessarily think that's a bad feature of a textbook if you're really interested in this topic. So the standard textbook is Tyrol and Fundenberg, and it's just called Game Theory. I have it on my shelf. Not even on my shelf. It's actually in front of me right now. But it is a graduate level textbook. Another pair of graduate textbooks would be the two books by Martin Osborne and Ariel Rubinstein. And actually, Martin Osborne's website has both of those in an electronic copy for free. Martin Osborne also has an introductory game theory textbook, which is quite good. But I would say it's not as good as, let's say, the... All right, have a good one, Jewish Bagel. It doesn't compare to any of the graduate textbooks. It's a good, like, primer for this stuff. And unfortunately, that one is not for free, but it's published by Oxford University Press. Now, if you... That's kind of the... That's the undergrad-level textbook. If you want, in my opinion, a nice, thin book, but a very helpful one, it's a book by Robert Gibbons called Game Theory for Applied Economists. It actually has endorsements from David Krepps, Gregory Mankiw. So these are two fairly well-regarded economists. And I think for my money, Game Theory for Applied Economists is actually a very helpful book to maybe give you some more concrete examples of these game theory concepts without giving up some of the rigor. So, and OP Bubble says, I think one of the big reasons you like this game was because it was based on a real life time on what happens before, and that you're able to experience what they experienced, what happened back, and how hard life was just worried what was going to happen and are going to be able to eat rather than survive for another day or two. Yeah, and we're actually talking a little bit. The fact that the ending is randomized forces you to treat the game, or treat the siege as if it's going to go on for multiple years, as it did in real life. The fact that you don't know when the game ends means that you're not going to consume all of your resources the day before the war ends, that you're going to continue to stock up until the war is done, which I think is a really wonderful touch. All right, so day four, my story. All the shelling, the sniper fire, and the lack of supplies makes you want to hide away, sit down, and cry. We cannot let them crush our spirit. We have to show them that they can't take away our dignity. It's difficult here, but you know how we did it. But you know how we did it on our street. I don't know how we did it on your street. And again, this is the important thing to remember here: is asking the question, why did this siege happen? In this case, it was, again, a very conscious effort to try and break the inhabitants to get the favorable outcome of the war on the Serb side. All right, so I'm going to need to find parts. The question is, do I try and make anything else? This is a really tough call. I think... Now is actually not a bad time to upgrade the stove. Yeah, I'm giving up a lot for it, but... Hey, I need help! Please open! Well, I can just say them again slower. So the standard text is Jean Tyrol and Drew Fundenberg, and the book is called Game Theory. Our mom is sick. Please help us. We live several blocks away from here. Our mom's very ill. She needs medications. Could you please spare any? Without your help, she'll die. After Daddy went to fight, we only have her. Please help us save her. And yeah. Thank you. Quickly, let's get the medicine to Mom. Those kids are very brave. They risk their lives walking around the neighborhood to save their mother. So here I just need to wait for these two to finish.
We couldn't just leave those poor kids with help. That would be callous. So one of the things to keep in mind is, you know, you do also need to keep the morale of your characters in line. So poor children, our hope our meds are enough to help their mother. Of course, this decision is not without consequence. I have a sick member on my team. All right, so I'll let him get some shut-eye. And Logan, just let me know when you've got that book down and I can give you the next recommendation. All right, so I could decide to make a radio. I mean, I'm eventually going to build it, but the question is, do I want to build it now? Yeah, you know what? This is probably a bad decision, but... Jean Tirole and Drew Fundenberg. Okay. The next one, I know one of them is called Bargaining and Markets, but I think the better thing to do is just look for Martin Osborne and Ariel Rubinstein. And they've got two graduate level textbooks. Hey, Kodiak Samurai. Actually, Logan, if you really want to know game theory, Kodiak Samurai knows better than than I do. Alright, so day four. The upcoming days should be nice and warm, perfect for a stroll in the park. The rebel leader instructed us to warn the listeners not to cross the front line. Failure to comply could result in death. Kodiak Samurai, we were talking about how... So, I don't know if you've played this game, but Logan is an undergrad in economics. So apparently the ending of this game is... It has like a random... It does like a random draw after a certain period of time to decide where the war ends. And so I thought it was an interesting application that by having a random end, you are going to have, you're going to treat this as if it's, you know, an infinitely repeated game. And so as a result, you don't, you know, consume all of your resources in the last day because you don't know what the last day is. And because this is based off of the Siege of Sarajevo that went on for multiple years, I just think it's a very nice way of creating that feeling of being in a seemingly endless siege without actually making the game, you know, go on for an endless amount of time. Again, I never know if this is a conscious decision on the developer's part or not, but I thought it was a very interesting decision, and so we talked a little bit about the, you know, a very hand-wavy sort of perspective on it. T-Clock, this is another thing that you love about the game. You have these choices that often do have very real consequences. What is the point within your own morality where you decide that you won't help others outside your group? I always decide to help people on this one, but... All right, the city of Pagoran is suffering extreme shortages of even the most vital supplies. If this goes on, people will soon become scavengers, scouring the city for anything of use. Hope you like classical. All right, so Bruno is awake, or not awake, but he's done sleeping. I think maybe what we do here is we cook up the last meals. Assuming that I have the, yeah, I do, but it's gonna be very hard to make Well, you know what? I don't even have enough water to make more of this, so let's just bite the bullet. We'll make our last three meals, and I'm not gonna eat them until I know my next path for getting food. So for those of you who have not played this game before or have not seen it, what do you guys think? I know we've got a few fans inside of the, you know, inside of the channel right now, but I'm always sort of curious what, I mean, so for me it's a very satisfying experience to just play this game and, you know, try and solve the puzzle and so on and so forth. But, you know, I've tried to do this justice in a way, right? I ideally, if I can, you know, share a little bit of what I know of this conflict, and, you know, again, it's obviously a little bit of a pet, I don't think I can say project, but it's definitely a pet sort of feeling of mine that these sorts of stories, these sorts of ideas are best understood when you focus on the individual and the individual decision. You know, whether it's Spec Ops The Line, whether it's This War of Mine, being able to focus on the individual in these environments, to me, it's the most interesting. All right, so we need to find, I mean, we need materials and we need food. So they say some people still live here. Against all odds, they must have some supply stock like canned food and possibly bandages or medicines. They don't want to trade. If we're desperate, we could try to steal from them. See, this communicates conflict to me. Some food, need a shovel. I think I'm gonna risk the supermarket. And we'll have two guys. We don't have a lot that we can steal, but we'll put two people on guard. You can comment if you want, Jesse Quill. Luba, you take downstairs. Got it. Igor, you take upstairs. So I'm gonna be very careful about what I take. Hey, you! Should be enough for both of us, don't worry. You really like how difficult this game is, even on the easiest settings. That's depressing, Jesse Quill. I was hoping this would be light. See, I keep having this illusion that I'm actually going to build this garden, but this is really not that good for gear, if I'm honest. Ah, they're taking all the good stuff. restarted about 12 times, got to day 25 on the second tie before all hell broke loose. Oh god, so this game's gonna cause me some grief. What was that? I really hope that wasn't in here. So, not so bad for components, but we're really hurting for food. Oh, there we go. I mean, I'll take this stuff, but I'm gonna dump it if I get better options. Yeah, I mean, they've added quite a few tools to customize the game now, which I think is really impressive. There's got to be something in here. Damaged helmet. What can I dump? Oh, that's the vegetables I wanted. God damn it, what am I gonna give up? Meds. Guys, when has this ever been a backseating stream? Come on, you know better than that. I really want those parts. I think we just go back there with the knife. I'm lucky that people are content. Oh, you know what? I can be listening to the radio. The upcoming days should be nice and warm, perfect for a stroll in the park. Some classical music. Most animals have disappeared from the streets. Keep that in mind when buying meat from dubious sources. The city of Porgrin is suffering extreme shortages on even the most vital supplies. If this goes on, people will soon become scavengers, scouring the city for anything of use. Music is playing. Alright, I really need to get self-sufficient, but... It's much easier to survive when you murder everybody, but everybody's miserable. Imagine that. All right, you know what? I'm gonna consume these, this medicine, just because I'm likely gonna get it the next time I visit. So we'll just wait for. Actually, while I'm at it. Still short on parts, but I think we can get that from the supermarket next time, so we'll head back. Do I use Celsius or Fahrenheit? I almost always use Celsius. I actually don't know Fahrenheit that well. All right, have a good one, OP Bubble. Thanks a lot for stopping by. I hope to see you next time as well. If we're not playing this War of Mine, we are going to be doing a couple more war games for the next few days. So if you like this kind of thing, we hope to see you again. Play the waiting game. So how's everybody doing? Hey, the Green Pact. Hope you're doing well. What I plan on creating for my survivors in the next few days, ideally I would create something that will allow me to catch small animals and a garden, but it really depends on what I pick up. I almost think at the supermarket I'm not going to be able to get all the stuff that I want. You know what? Run and get dinner, then you can go back to sleep. I mean, the stuff that I really need, I need a still, I need a garden, and I need a trap for animals. And then I need to, like, secure my house. I need to clear up all these. I need to patch up all these holes, so I definitely need, I need to get a lot done. You can enjoy the music, my friend. Why do I think it's important to get... I don't think it's important to get right away, but I need water to cook. Actually, I've got a lot of water, so I shouldn't make the still... I should make the other stuff first. But it's basically just so I can become self-sufficient. If I can make vegetable... If I can get vegetables, meat, and water, then I'm going to at least have basic survival taken care of. The fact that they include temperature also suggests to me that the game's eventually gonna get cold. So I'll probably need to do things like conserve wood. Okay, lots of meds, huge amount of weapons, some parts. The supermarket is actually not a good place to go. This old apartment building is owned by an elderly couple and their son. They are still around, somehow managing to fend off looters. They probably have supplies like food and meds, but won't be willing to share them with us. We can try to steal or take them by force. Lockpicks might come in handy. I'm not ready to go that far yet. I think we go to the Shield School, and we bring a crowbar with us. I heard they had classes when the shelling started. Poor kids. There's a side of me that says I should just run through this place and open as many doors as I can with the crowbar, so I don't need to come back and break stuff up. Okay. Oh wow. I'm getting nothing. This might be a bust. Oh my god, I took Pavel! This is going to be a disaster. I wanted to bring Marco because he's my better scavenger. I wasn't even paying attention. That's a really big screw up on my part. Hey, Miss Ariella. How are you doing? If we could get a shout out for the lovely Miss Ariella, she was actually going to give me a game today and then found out that I already owned it, so it's the thought that counts though. She is an Australian caster. I originally met her in Vancouver, but she has since gone back to the southern continent. Wonderful individual, and if you tend to watch me later at night, she's actually a really wonderful caster to follow just because she is a little bit more appropriate to that time zone. But she, again, lovely person, very diverse set of games, and is actually a little bit better at completing games than I am, and has a lot more satisfaction out of doing so. So, definitely somebody worth following, and of course worth, one of the great people on Team Panda who I really, really like hanging out with, so. Oh, we're alright. I screwed up my, scavenging mission here, so I'm gonna be, a little short-changed on this. At least we're getting some good resources. So I think the next step, even if I can't take everything that I want, I'm going to spend the rest of the night clearing out everything that I can. So I'll give a little bit of my thought process behind some of these things here. I'm not going to open up this door because this is going to be some wasted time while I open up, while I clear out two piles of rubble, and I already have a path that gets me there. So what I'm going to try and do is sort of open up access to as many places as I can. That way I don't need to worry about bringing the crowbar back, and that will give me an additional inventory slot to work with. You blame OCD. It's a good trait to have, though. I wish I was a little more consistent at finishing finishing games, but I also like having diversity, so I... They took our food again. I'm so sorry, bro. Hey, these are the nice homeless people. I'm gonna feel like super bad about stealing from them. So I need to come back with a saw blade eventually. Alright, now that is an indicator that means that you're stealing, and people will detect that you're doing that no matter what. So I actually shouldn't be taking from that unless I'm ready for a fight. Yeah, they're about as homeless as I am, if I'm totally honest. Oh my god, I want all of that. In fact, really, I think these guys are just grad students. A note left behind for someone. I prepared the secret stash behind the fridge, like you asked. I already put some stuff there so you can see if it works for you. Alright, let's get out of here. Oh, is the stream being a little unkind to you as well? Yeah, I had somebody in here earlier saying that the connection was weak. Oh wow, they were both asleep. I really hope we didn't get raided. Of course we did. Someone tried to rob us. They must have been more scared than us. They didn't do much harm. We had some weapons, but not enough for everyone. Bruno and Marco were wounded, and the attackers took a few things. We should put more people on guard. God damn it. Alright, well, fortunately I have bandages, so it's not a disaster, but man, I'm not happy with that, how that turned out. I used to be an optimist, one of those people who would have sworn that the war wouldn't come. Wars happened far away in third world countries. Or so I thought. Even when I was listening to the news getting scarier day by day, I did not believe what all that was about to happen. Well, still, Ariella, I'm sorry that you're not able to enjoy the stream. Clearly, there's a Trump supporters outside. Yeah, speaking of news getting scarier day by day, here's something to make you all uncomfortable. Think about the line of attack that... So there's actually two things that interest me about the news cycle for the election today. The first... Or I guess it's been the last couple of days. So the first is Hillary Clinton's line of attack on Trump, which is the guy can't be trusted with nuclear weapons. Now imagine that being leveled at any other Republican nominee, and it's very easy to have like outrage as a response. So imagine that Obama does this against Romney. The response from the Republicans is, no, he won't start a nuclear war. Now, yeah, it totally does, because the car's like driving away. But when it comes to Trump, you've got, you know, there's no serious Republican who can credibly say, no, he's not going to start a war with nuclear weapons, which is why that's such a good line of attack. Now, after additional revelations of Trump University, what does Trump do? He goes up and he delivers another racist speech about Mexico, and he has this quote where he refers to one of his African American supporters as like my black guy or something like that, and all of a sudden that's the news item. It's not, you know, what a scummy place Trump University was. It's now, oh my God, he said another outrageous thing. And of course, the people who are already going to support him already knows he says outrageous things. So that's really I'm really surprised at the news media for being so easily played like that. But I suppose that's why he's had the success that he has. So... The upcoming days should still be nice and warm, perfect for a stroll in the park. Minus the snipers. Some classical music playing. Most animals have disappeared from the streets. Keep that in mind when buying meat from dubious sources. More or less all the stuff that we've known. Hey, Holly Makes a Wish. Good to see you again. Well, I won't say no university. I won't say in no universe he would win. I think there is actually a credible path through which he wins. Do I believe that's going to happen? No, I don't believe that. I don't believe that will be the outcome. But I also think. I think the people who say that it's an impossibility are maybe. Maybe overstating the case a bit. Doesn't make sense to keep this on the ground level. What, are there no fans of Saint Bernard of Vermont in here? Does nobody here believe in the socialist takeover of the Democratic Party? Ah, so we give up one raw food in exchange for two. Neat. Or we can give up one fertilizer for two. Or what else can we do? We can give up canned food. That doesn't make any sense. But yeah, I'll give up a raw food for that. Vegetables are actually super important. Let's see what we can. Let's see what we need to make this this garden. So I need 17 and 15. In a book. Let's see what we get for the book. Don't think I'm ready to give this up yet. Also got a lot more fire than I thought we did, which means I've been wasting those resources. Yeah, see, I can't blow my load on these things yet. I need to actually transform them into something worth trading. Oh wait, I want those vegetables. Oh wow, this guy is okay. Really nothing I can. So I should maybe just try and transform this stuff into some meals, but so Logan, why do you say that Sanders is the best option if you dislike him? I'm interested in that. So here's what I'm thinking as far as my... Oh, hang on. I didn't even know there was this read up here. So fortunately, our shelter is in a place where we can get some respite from the war. We only have one chair. We have beds and we sleep in decent conditions. If someone gets sick or wounded, they'll have a place to rest. We've made a radio and we like listening to it. We have a few books. A good book helps forget the horrors of war. Staying here offers slight respite in these hard times. We lack cigarettes. We have breaches in the wall. Our shelter is not safe, and we have to constantly be on guard. So I think once I make my garden, it will be the best garden. I start patching up those holes. Filling in those holes, whatever one does with holes.
Oops. Sorry, guys. Don't you love this pop? Really love the concept of this game, getting the focus away from the people on the battlefield in war and putting it on the people affected by it. Yeah, I mean, it's a little bit like what we said at the beginning, Kite. You know, this has been the most common human experience of war, is that of a civilian who really doesn't have a lot of control over the events. But it's funny, I mean, there's been so few... I mean, in one sense, this is one of the reasons why I wanted to do a series on war, because war is a setting for a lot of games, but it's very hard to say that a lot of... it's hard to say that a lot of these games that have war as a setting are necessarily about conflict. So... I wanted to take a minute to sort of highlight some of these games that I think do a very good job of... you know, of displaying it, of sort of showing, Alright, so let's make sure we do this right. We're gonna put two guards up. I think the shelled school is still where we go. And I should be prioritizing... I should be prioritizing materials. I think this is the locked door. Yep. I'll clear these out if I have time, but... We're doing okay as far as the materials are concerned. Okay, so this should be it, really. Let's take the time to clear out some of the debris. Sleep is for the weak. Methamphetamines can counter that. Euro Truck 2 Simulator 2 taught you this. Jesus Christ, guys. I will also say too, I think the I did get the soundtrack for this. I think it's a really well done soundtrack. I think it captures the mood extremely well. I think we're gonna have time to clear out both bits of debris. I don't think we're gonna be able to do that much else, though. You should know by now, Chalk, you're gonna push me to be the worst human. I mean, I should play Euro Truck Simulator on cast sometime. Jesse Quill, you don't know if he needs help with that. Yeah, I think anybody who saw the cast last night, the fact that I'm apparently picking fights with teammates, can tell you I don't need any help being a terrible person. Seems like a nice human. It's an act that I can sustain a couple of days a week when I cast. A lot of people, I don't know, like in my class, I think there's a lot of people waiting for my presentation so they can get sort of revenge, that they can ask like tough questions of me because I ask tough questions in the seminars. But it's never to try and screw somebody's paper. Like, I've always benefited from people asking pointed questions. It shows that, one, they've paid attention to me, and two, that they, you know, that they actually want to see my paper do well. But I think there's maybe, I don't know if it's like embarrassment or something like that, but there's definitely a style of person who does not react well to that. And I suppose I should maybe just try and be more careful in how I present it, but I don't know, it's tough. And I will read Logan's message in a minute. Oh, got it. You know what? I hate doing this. No, you know what? I'm gonna keep the wood. I know I'm always scarce on parts, so. So much stuff here. There's a cornucopia. All right, let's get out of here. All right, so Logan says, when it comes down to Trump, he's obviously the worst case scenario. As far as debate goes, Trump is very good at detracting from the actual issues. So in a debate against Hillary, all he has to do is, I know this is an issue, but how about them emails, Hillary? How about Benghazi? Whereas Bernie, as far as I know, doesn't have all of this dirt that can be brought up and used to detract from the issues. So my response to that is that if you recall the New York Post article that sort of raised some questions in terms of his plan to break up the financial sector, there were some very legitimate questions being asked about how well he had planned or thought through the consequences of his policy decisions. And so, yes, there is the scandal with the emails. But if, again, as we were talking about earlier, the attack on you cannot trust Trump with nuclear weapons is actually a very strong line of attack, precisely because Republicans can't actually turn around and say, oh, he wouldn't be irresponsible with them. He is a manifestly irresponsible man. And people just don't want to roll the dice on that. And so the appeal to me of Clinton as the anti-Trump, as opposed to Sanders, you know, the other very populist candidate. In fact, I would say, as far as trade is concerned, there's no difference whatsoever between Sanders and Trump. The difference is that Sanders, you know, is more in line with the people, you know, who will watch this stream, let's say. He's more in line with kind of what you and I would want to say, right? Like, generally, I'm going to assume most people here are fairly progressive in their stance on social issues. Whereas Trump is a boor. And, you know, I don't think anybody very seriously would consider the positions that he has on race or immigration. But the big thing is that not everybody thinks that way, right? An election is, you know, is everyone. And so the appeal to me of Clinton as the anti-Trump is just simply that she is much more of the same. Like, she is an establishment candidate. She's sort of, maybe not in the middle, but she's the closest to the middle out of those two candidates. And if I just sort of track kind of what happens with Obama, so Obama gets elected with a huge mandate, right? And then implements Obamacare, and what happens? Congress sort of turns Republican. And, you know, the complaint has always been that Congress is obstructing Obama's agenda. And yet I think this is very clearly the wish of the electorate. Because you have Obama Romney, people know the score, right? There's going to be lots of dysfunction in Washington. And yet they voted for the same set of circumstances, which sort of says to me that they say it's like, okay, you know, we like Obama, but we don't want him to implement his full agenda. And I think because you've now seen multiple elections that give you that outcome, I think that's basically the people sort of saying it's like, we don't want to go that far to the left. We want to like rein that into the center a little bit. And so again, Clinton has quite a few issues, but I see her as the more likely presidential candidate just simply because she fills that space in the middle. Now, the reason why you're seeing all of the positioning behind Trump is the fact that for so long people have set her up as the Antichrist. And, you know, all of these people. So, I mean, if you think of the Republican debate setting up as, you know, saying that Hillary Clinton would be the worst thing that happens to the country, if you set yourself up as saying that literally any other opportunity is the death of the American Republic, then, you know, you're left with the nominee, which is, you know, this reality television guy. But again, I don't think most people think like Republican congressmen, so. But yeah, I will say, Holly Makes a Wish makes a very good point to say it's like you've positioned yourself, but it's definitely, you know, why you vote versus, well, I guess you explained why you vote. But yeah, I think answering why you don't like a candidate is also worthwhile. Hello, Pumpaneco. It's wonderful to see you again. I didn't speak much in Elkanu's channel, but I'm loving him playing Mushroom 11 or Champignon 11. The upcoming days should still be nice and warm, perfect for a stroll in the park. Some classical music. Looks like we're getting all the same messages still. All right, you'll forgive me if I don't go back to the pop. Let's go back to classical music.
Bonjour, je suis Quill. Je m'appelle Norman. Comment ça va?
Or is it comment allez-vous? He finished the mushroom game yesterday. I really want to play it now, actually. It looks really good. Kite doesn't know what I said, but it sounds nice. Gonna be right back, cook some oatmeal. Let me see if I can find some... Let me see if I can find some French things to say. Oh, looks like I still got internet problems on the laptop. What's going on with this? So, Pumpaneco, have you played?
Bonjour, tu es un oiseau dans ma fenêtre. Ça va bien, Jessica. Merci.
So, hello, you are a mouse. I don't know Dom, but my door. No, my window. A mouse something my window. And the reason I know Fenêtre is from the word fenestrate or defenestrate. Oh, a bird! Damn it, sorry. I think I can go one more day without food. Actually, I know I can go much further without food, but I don't want to risk too much. All right, well, I still have a little time left in the day, so I'm going to see if I can find one of my French textbooks. Yeah, sorry, Pumpkin Echo, I forgot to ask if you have played this or if you've seen this before. It is quite a difficult game, Pumpkin Echo. I don't know how well I will survive, but we'll see.
Julien Charles découvrait les cuisines françaises dans un restaurant de Rouen. Il prend alors des cours en cordon bleu, Blue Ribbon, célèbre école de cuisine parisienne. Puis elle écrit plusieurs guides culinaires.
Sorry, it's actually very dark in here. So this is, one, my pronunciation is horrible, and I'm actually having a little difficulty reading the book. Sorry, folks. All right. Oh, you know what I didn't do? I didn't try to build my garden. Yes, you do know I have a desk lamp. You also probably know that it's not on my desk. Hello, Liatu. Good to see you again. So, ladies and gentlemen, you're looking, searching for a good sleep. When the sun is up, you wish you all a relaxing day. Gesundheit, you hear some French baguette maker speaking. Have a good 114. And guys, Liatu is a wonderful, I will say. Oh yes, for Bernie Sanders fans, he is a Scandinavian streamer. So that land of milk and honey. Of course, Pumpkin Echo is based in France, which is also a very progressive country. So you've got all of the people from these countries that you envy for their social programs. But Liatu is a streamer, wonderfully diverse streamer, and a very big supporter of this cast. So definitely check him out, toss him a follow. I like, and again, I always keep selling him on the basis of his diversity, but I absolutely mean it. Like, he is doing a little bit of everything. Liatu Dem had to use an incognito browser, tried disabling all kinds of plugins, but Twitch just fails to load without incognito. I'm sorry to hear that. Wish you could emigrate to Sweden if you could handle the cold. I'm sure they have jackets in Sweden. They haven't
you know, completely fallen to Stalinist Soviet standards. Wake up, motherfuckers! Still don't think I want to give up the... Alright, so that's gonna be theft. Don't want to do that. Can't handle the code. Literally, you have Reynards. Your fingers and tones trip. Oh my goodness. Sorry to hear that. I think I like these parts more than electronics. Ooh. I gotta go for the food. One of the reasons you're moving to Hawaii. That's exciting. If I'm moving anywhere, it's just further east in Canada. Decidedly worse climate compared to my current place, but hopefully for a cool job, so. You know what? I'm gonna clear out a little more debris. And while we're doing this... Oh god, the soundtrack, I love it. Get to work, damn it! Not paying you to stand around. Economist analyst group. Économique et service des sciences sociales. ACE. Niveau 4. Tremont. ACE taux de remuneration annuelle. Aperçu. En tant qu'économiste analyste et statistique Canada, votre rôle consiste à entreprendre l'analyse des dons des programmes statistiques et à aider à la préparation de la documentation analytique destinée à un usage interne et la publication. Les économistes analystes doivent participer à l'analyse des tendances et des développements socio-économiques pour évaluer les visibilités et les incidences des programmes statistiques nouveaux ou modifiés. Vous pouvez aussi avoir l'occasion d'aider à l'élaboration des recommandations en vue d'améliorer les méthodes et les activités statistiques. Neither do I, Hull. Holly makes a wish. I tried. That's embarrassing. But I will get better, especially if I get that job. Can't handle the heat at the finish of summer? What about at the start? Merci, Pumpernickel. Now you know the job I'm applying for. Night was calm.
Alright, so I think it's time to make some meals. Must get some food at all costs. Gotta think some way to do it. So what I'm going to be doing here is making some of my, I gotta get Mark. I definitely need to feed Marco, otherwise he's going to slow down during the raids, which I can't handle. Alright, can I make my garden? Yes, I can. Just a nice little grow up in the back. Uh-oh, I don't think we have any medicine for the kids. That sucks. Oh, they're still hungry, damn it. That's gonna be hard to deal with, actually. Oh, and he's sad. Hello again, we're hungry. Oh god. Hi again, thanks. Thanks to you, our mom is getting better, but she's still weak and we have no food left. We are very hungry. Can you give us something to eat, please? That's two canned food, that's so much. I mean, as it is, I didn't have the resources, but it was sad that we couldn't help those hungry children. Oh, this is where it's all gonna start going wrong. We'd share some food with those hungry children if we only had some left. So at least they sort of understand the situation, but let's make one more. I think we just gotta cook everything that we have at this point. Oh no, you know what? I shouldn't cook everything because I'm going to need more bait for the trap. Well, no, because I'm going to get the food back anyway, so yeah, we're going to put everything in that trap. So herbs are not going to do that much for me. I actually need to upgrade this to a proper garden. And I need a heat lamp. Oh my god, where do I get that from? Makes useful electronic. Okay, so we just need one more parts, and we'll probably be able to make that heat lamp. Should probably get him listening to the radio. So many languages in chat. I actually really like it. The thing that disappoints me the most about Twitch is the tendency for people to say, you know, only speak English. I think it's a big missed opportunity because, I mean, English is already so dominant on the platform. Oh, you're listening to Radio Pogren. We regret to announce that our colleague Jovan died this morning. Or is it maybe Jovan? He was shot by a sniper on his way to work. He will be missed. The rebel spokesman informed us that some districts might become inaccessible to civilians because the government forces are planning to storm the city. They hope to end the fighting before the international intervention. Music is playing. But yeah, I think it's a bit of a shame that people are short-sighted on this because English is already very dominant on this platform. And I don't necessarily think it hurts to have people speak in their language. I think it's much more inclusive to say if you'd like to speak in your native language, you can. Now, obviously, there's a little bit of a shame in the sense that maybe you aren't able to communicate with your, you know, with their chat the way that you would want. But I think kind of the job in my case is to give content in English that I, you know, that is worth... worth engaging with, right? And if I'm not doing my job well and people want to speak amongst themselves and I'm not adding any value, I don't necessarily see why I should say I don't really see why I would need to tell people how they can can't address each other. Yeah, fair enough, but then, I mean, how many, if people aren't going to be able to understand it, I mean, if, I suppose if somebody were to say, you know, they're speaking very poorly of me, I would intervene at that point. But it seems to me if you have people from the same channel and who have been able to get along with each other, it seems a little unfair to assume that they're going to start turning nasty to each other, when they enter your stream. I should really find out what I... Oh yeah, it was parts that I needed to upgrade that. I think we just wind up going back to the... the school. There's so much stuff that we can get there. Gonna learn Hawaiian. And it says lots of food, but I don't believe it. I'm tempted to bring the crowbar, but I don't think that's going to be the right way to go about this. Oh, we need water. All right. Still not what I needed, unfortunately. Yeah,
So it's just the alcohol that I'm missing. And I'm not gonna steal from that guy. So I mean, it's really tempting to take this stuff, but I mean, I guess I can give up one water in exchange for medicine, so. The real question is whether or not I come back here without a saw. I don't see much of a point, to be completely honest. But I mean, that's obviously gonna be where the food is, so. Someone tried to rob us. There were just a couple of scavengers, so we managed to fend them off. Thankfully, we were all armed, and none of us were wounded, and the attackers didn't steal anything. We are able to defend ourselves. Everyone should choose one happy memory, and it can't just be good. It has to be grand. When it gets so bad you want to sit down and cry, when your life seems forfeit, you close your eyes and go back to your happy moment. It's not easy, but you have to try. Nothing. Still warm? Jovan's still dead? There's still a rebellion going on. So the only drawback about this strategy, stream-wise, let me just double-check that. Oh, hello! This is very good news. Alright, so we've got a surplus of fertilizer. I really don't like doing this, because I know I'm going to need this for my vegetable garden, but I think we need to spread out the resources a little bit better. Actually, you know what? I think we eat up. Let's get Marco to chow down. Then we'll be able to cook a little bit more food. Oh, nope, because we don't have vegetables. I'm a moron. That's fine. We can still top everyone off. So we need one fuel. I think what I'm going to do is I'm going to start patching up some of these holes. So I'm just going to double check what I need for upgrades. So to get my heat lamp, I'm going to need 15 wood. Okay, so first of all, what do we need to patch up a hole? 10 and 2. Let me just grab something to write this down with. Why the hell is my wireless not working?
It's weird, because, like, if I'm able to broadcast, it can't be a problem with my internet connection. Alright. So, for every board up, we need 10 wood. 2 components. Ooh, don't you dare waste those resources. To get vegetables, I need 30 components, 15 wood, 3 parts, 4 electronics. And to make the lamp, I don't know what it'll take to make the lamp, but I know I'm going to need 60. So in the end, I'm going to need 60 components, 30 wood, 8 parts, and 9 electronics, which means I need more of everything. So we sit and wait. Get back to bed. Logan says, it's really bothering you right now. There was a topic one of your professors mentioned when he said he thought it was a good topic to write about because, to his knowledge, there's been no writing. You cannot remember for the life of you what it was. The only thing you know is that it was regarding taxation. Well, that narrows it down. So here's a question for you guys. This is not a loyalty test, but I am a little curious about this because we were having a conversation about this in the Team Panda Slack. Have any of you guys actually followed the instructions from the bot, either to follow me on Twitter or to follow the stream? I definitely know there's some people who have followed after that message has come out. But I am a little curious if anybody here right now has ever actually used the spam that the bot has given, or is it just like white noise in the background that's cluttering up the chat? Look at you, Jesse Quill, so loyal. Just listen to me talk. Yeah, it's kind of what I thought. Most people already knew about the stream. You know what? I should really see what this thing can do for me. I'm just kind of like waiting to turn it into a garden without seeing what I can actually make out of this. I can make fertilizer, but I make it from food, which is a disaster. And I am not at all interested in making herbs. Oh yeah, I said it wasn't a loyalty test. Ignore everything that I said that was talking about lack of loyalty. All right, I think it's time for Pavel to, you know, improve his football game. All right, and up, and down, and up, and down, and up, and down. All right, that's good. Oh, hang on, I gotta get some medicine. Nah, that's the wrong medicine. I better go back down here. See this. You know what? I gotta use the bathroom now. Oh, wait, the bathroom's on the other side. Never mind.
All right, here we go. Oh, hang on. What about that gap? No, never mind, Pavel. You're all good. Pavel doesn't have the caloric intake to waste on this. Hey, Bruno, you know, get your mind off the smokes. Oh, no, you can't take the stairs. Back down. Nope. Yeah, you know what? Running up and down the stairs will probably make you strong. Oh, Pavel's all tuckered out. How does he play a whole football game? All right. So, I mean, I know it says lots of food, meds, and stuff like that, but all of this is probably going to be hiding. Leotu, thank you very much for that host. All right. Both are going to be guarding. All right, so what do we do for Marco? We can try the supermarket, but just... I don't really think that's worth it. This seems wrong because... we've got nothing to look for there unless we're willing to steal. Not interested in doing that. City center used to be beautiful with parks, squares, and monuments surrounded by old buildings. Unfortunate, numerous incidents with civilians shot out earned the nickname the Sniper Junction. We may find valuable things there, but it's very risky. Ruined villas. They say some people still live there. Against all odds, they must have some supplies stocked, like canned food and possibly bandages or medicine. They don't want to trade. If we're desperate, we could try to steal from them. So yeah, we're starting to get to the point where we need to start doing some bad things. This old apartment building is owned by an elderly couple and their son. They are still around, somehow managing to fend off looters. They probably have supplies like food and meds, but won't be willing to share them with us. We can try to steal or take them by force. Lockpicks might come in handy. All right. I have a feeling this is not going to end well for me. Used to be such a lively place. I miss these guys. Watch out. You don't want to get shot by the sniper. Ugh. I'm actually feeling a little sweaty doing this. Bastard is on the... is in the hotel, covers the whole damn street. Oh, neat. Neat. Okay. Oh, you're kidding me. Run for it. Oh, yeah, I got hit again. Okay, so I gotta wait between shots. Jesus, this is gonna be super bad. The sniper shot me. You're lucky he didn't kill you. Don't I know it? All right. Fortunately, we've got a surplus of bandages. Gotta try from the other side. Son of a bitch. Okay. So I wait for him to take a shot. Go for it. Whew. Jesus, run! He's fucked. Oh, maybe not. Alright, wait for another shot and then we go. Go for it. Oh my god, this game is so good, guys. And a perfect music cue. So fortunately, we've kind of secured our path.
I really can't afford to get hit. Oh, perfect. Okay. We definitely need some components, but I'll ditch the two. Somebody shut up that baby! God, this is such a hard choice. I think I'm gonna keep with it for... No, you know what? I really do need electric parts. I need to break everything open. I mean, I really need those bandages, but not at the expense of losing other stuff. So basically, Marco's staying in bed all day tomorrow, which is going to mess around a little bit with my plans, but... Probably the food is behind that door. I really need to get a saw then. Hey, Matsuro. Yes, I believe this is in the new... This has come from the new patch, which is focused on children. Now, I am not playing... I'm not playing the DLC, which has a focus on children and war. But I believe whether or not you own the DLC, they did add a few new items. And welcome, by the way. Okay, so how do I get up there? It's probably through the sun. Yeah. Okay. So good for resources, not good for food. And I don't need to bring a knife next time. So I take it you are a fan of the game then? Gonna wait till hear the gunshot. The thing I'm scared about is there we go, run for it. He's gonna get hit though. Oh, you idiot. There we go, go for it. Alright. I will be live tomorrow, Kite. I will probably be playing a different game though. Alright, I think this is the furthest I've made it in this game, actually. Here, brought some meds. Now, if you excuse me, I need to have this wound dressed. Okay. I think Bruno needs to start cooking. What happened at the sniper junction could have ended much worse. That is absolutely true. I'm glad I was able to help that wounded man. I'm glad I could help that man. Every one of us could be in his position. Oh, you know what? Everybody's going hungry, actually. To conserve. Oh. So we have what we need to do the upgrade. He's looking to see if anybody was playing the new DLC. Yeah, I'm sorry to disappoint you on that, Matsuro 001. Apparently, it is just the child mechanics that have been added. And my intention actually, so it was bad timing on my part,
Although I didn't know that the new DLC was going to be released at the time that it was. But this is going to be basically a bit of an ongoing series on war that I was planning on. Oh god. It's for barter. All right. I thought it was going to be another team member. I didn't know if I could support it. But yeah, so the effort here has been trying to play some games which are focused on war, not just like a setting, but we did Spec Ops The Line. Now we're on This War of Mine, and I have at least two more games that I'll be playing as part of the series. But you know, just making an effort. Obviously, now we've relaxed a little bit on the commentary in terms of the Bosnian war, but definitely making an effort to try and, you know, take these games, you know, seriously, trying to make it, I don't know, to take it at face value, I guess, for lack of a better term, and engage with the stories that they're telling. Okay, let's see if we can get away with dumping some of these books in exchange for, no, you know what, we get components by going on a run. So we can probably give up one of these. This gives us our garden. So the next priority is going to be to make a water still, and then we're going to start patching up these holes. At some point, I'm also going to start needing to make a heater, but again, trying to do it on an as-needed basis. Oh no! All right, so maybe that water still is a higher priority than I thought. That's going to be tough. Hey, Satan could beat it, Jesus. I'm glad you like it. People are scouring the streets and abandoned houses for everything that can be eaten, burned, or traded. If aid doesn't reach the city soon, the situation will become dire. So it's pretty grim out there. Sleep, damn you! Alright, so we're gonna relax a little bit so we can get our strength up. I'm just gonna take this opportunity to take a quick peek at my router and see what the hell is going on.
At least the nice music is nice. Just wanted to stop in and say hi before you went to bed. Well, I really appreciate that, Satan could be up, Jesus. Actually, so here's a question for you guys regarding the commentary. I mean, I know we sort of started talking a little bit about the Bosnian War, and obviously we had the game theory thing that I wanted out. I don't really know if the commentary in terms of talking about sort of the decisions I'm making about what I'm building is really enough to sustain the cast, or if you guys are just here because you really like the game, but was there anything that you guys were interested in or wanted to talk about in terms of the game? Just because, again, like, I don't necessarily think I'm in a position to lecture people on history. But, you know, on the other hand, I don't want to just be, you know, standing around, you know, waiting for the day to end, not really saying that much, so. Oh, new areas. So we can't go to Sniper Junction due to fighting. Quiet House is for stealing. City Hospital, it's been shelled several times. There was a fire and numerous bandit raids, and yet it still operates. Some wards still admit patients and save lives, mostly thanks to Dr. Jeffimow, a renowned surgeon who remains steadfast and keeps others in line. The hotel, Pogoron Travel Agency used to own this small yet luxurious hotel. The owners fled the city just before the siege, along with the foreign journalists who had been staying there. Someone moved in there recently and spread the news that they were willing to barter. Maybe he has something useful for us. So the problem here is... So both of these have... I think we're going to try the hotel. I need to bring a weapon, unfortunately. And I'm not in a really great state to fight. The game just crashed. My God, there's a lot of you. Let's try that again. Sorry, guys. Started watching people play this War of Mine to see them fail at the game. happy to oblige you there. Is it really going to make us do the day, too? That is a damn shame. I'm glad I could... Oh, right. So we already covered all this. All right, I'm sorry, guys. Where's Bruno? Make this man a dinner. Or not, actually, because we only have the one food. Looks like I don't know. I mean, this is the first time I've played the game. Sorry, guys, I gotta tab out for another second. This is the first time I've, like, done a sustained playthrough of the game. I did kind of a couple of little tooling around playthroughs. Unisaur, thank you very much for that follow. I really appreciate that. But yeah, the like most of the time that I've played this, it's been sort of make up your mind, Bruno. It's been kind of you know, just okay, I want to make sure that this is working on stream, not like any sustained effort to try and make the thing work. But I don't know, it's fun, and it fits sort of the survival mold, right? It's a little bit like a puzzle game you need to resource manage. I really enjoyed a game called Gods Will Be Watching, which is much more intense. It's a very Dark Souls-ish kind of approach to sort of resource management. And so in some ways, this is sort of familiar to some other stuff that I've played before. But, I mean, again, the really inspired step about this one is just... It seems so obvious when you... you know, when you play the game, but to actually say it's like, okay, so survival is a big genre in gaming right now, and yet nobody has actually bothered to do the most direct survival experience that is unfortunately a very real feature of life for people. And to the private message, I see you, I register, thank you very much for your continued presence. I hope you have a good sleep. But yeah, I think you know, like I said, I tried my best, especially at the start, to talk about the context of the game, to talk about, I think, some of the design decisions that they made to sort of communicate these ideas intentionally or unintentionally. But just like Spec Ops The Line, I think the big thing is that the reason why this game is great and why I think it does more for, you know, making you sympathetic to the cause that it's supporting. This actually gives me a nice little opportunity to see what I need for the still or for the collector. So I need wood and parts. Let's get our sleep underway so we can move up. There is a I think in my view, a tendency for people to get very sort of navel-gazy. It's, you know, I'm gonna do a game about this experience, and you know, you need to appreciate the art, this kind of stuff. And the problem that I have with that take is how do I put this nicely? He does not have the things that I want, but he does have food, so we'll try and be nice to him. Maybe vegetables? Well, can't blame a guy for trying, right? Herbs? I'm willing to do that deal. Maybe there's a way I can... Oh, wow. Nice. Okay. Let's try and get a little more out of this then. Off with you. All right, have a good one, Leah, too. But yeah, so, you know, you can say it's like, I'm gonna make a game about this experience, and, you know, you need to appreciate it for the art that it is. And the I don't think that's the way to reach people. I don't think that's the way to, you know, to communicate your point or to create a gaming experience that will last with people. You know, Spec Ops: The Line is a very conventional shooter in a lot of ways, but it's very effective in communicating its story through the conventions of that genre. This War of Mine is very similar. You know, I don't think there's a lot in here that I haven't done in existing games, right? You know, the crafting mechanic is what it is. Resource management is something that I've done in other games. And yet this is a very compelling story. You know, the music is beautiful, the visuals are amazing. This is a very, very good looking game. You know, you get a good story, you know, you get the, as you kind of go through the game, you get to learn a little bit more about these people, you care about them in the same way that, you know, XCOM, you bond with your characters through going through missions with them, again, through the survival story, through learning a little bit of their biography, and that you grow attached to these people. And I think it's a really wonderful thing that they did to open the game up to workshop stories. I think that's a very nice touch. And so, yeah, it's overall, like, it's a game that it's very well put together. They focused on making something that's fun, something that if you like playing games, if you like playing sort of the survival genre, then you are going to feel right at home. And yet, you know, it's about something a little bit bigger than, you know, than most of the games in that genre. I think it's a really impressive achievement. I think that team should be very proud of what they did. All right, but I've been babbling, and so let me just take a look at what some of these other things are. We've got thermoregulator. We can use it to maintain optimum temperature of the heater and save wood. We'll also need it to make a distiller if we want to purify alcohol. Mixer, use it to mix gunpowder and medicine ingredients. We don't need the heat lamp. So I need wood and I need parts. So basically wood parts and components. It's going to be the same throughout the game, I think, at this point. I'm going to try and run out as much as I can as far as the food situation is concerned, but we're probably going to make a trip to the hospital. There's even a side of me that thinks maybe we should just let Marco sleep through the night, but nah, you know what? I think we'll do what we originally did. This is probably going to be more of a scouting run more than anything, but it doesn't make any sense not to go prepared. I went to the hotel last time, didn't I? Oh well. Say it still operates, maybe just a rumor. So this looks like somebody's gonna cause trouble for me. Hey man, don't do anything stupid, okay? Won't mess with you, sir. Here I'm going to be on my best behavior, one, because I can't really run, and two, I'm already in a really bad way as far as health goes. So we won't even be touching that because it's theft.
gonna assume opening that is also theft. There's an excerpt from the damage report after one of the shellings. General surgery, 32 patients, 3 killed, 12 wounded. Neurology, 13 patients, 0 killed, 2 wounded. Children's ward, 34 patients, 32 killed, 2 wounded. Intensive care, 55 patients, 9 killed, 10 wounded. It seems like the children's ward took the most damage. So for those of you who are maybe new to the game, this is an indicator that what you are doing is stealing. And that will cause people to have... Oh, you don't look well, sir. Can I help you? Please? I really do need your help, but... but yeah, so if you steal something, people will turn hostile against you. In fact, I believe even if you, like, take a look, this is the big challenge, of course, is that all the good stuff here is not necessarily going to be available. And I believe it counts as a theft. I believe people still turn hostile even if you, if you're not seen committing the theft, so it's definitely a very tricky proposition here. Hello, nurse. If you get worse, I'll be here to help you. Okay. Great. And that was legit pickup, so we're actually covered for food for the next little while. I really needed that. Oh god, we're actually doing really well on this. We have to keep taking the food. This is actually a really good call to go here. Hi, don't make any trouble. This is probably where all the good stuff is. But of course, it comes at the cost. There's no hiding places in here, and there's no, and a lot of this is all theft, so. So if I need, basically if I need more stuff, I'm gonna come here. It's a shame that I brought the knife, because I'm completely not going to need it. But I'm just gonna limp my way out to the exit. I didn't even pay attention to that. I'm not really interested in any of the... Okay, not bad. All right, and a calm night. Nice. I didn't know he slept at all. Actually, he should have been guarding. All right. Let's start with the radio, and then I'll. I don't think I have what I need to make the rainwater collector. Still ransacking. Cigarettes and tobacco are presently used in Polaren as currency. Nevertheless, the city is running short on them. What will happen if they run out completely? So, good for negotiation. Unfortunately, we have a smoker and no real means of creating them, so. Still need the parts. So I think hotel comes next. Now the real dilemma here is that I lose the water that I need to make the food. So I sadly can't do that. We're really close to self-sufficiency, but unfortunately that last really important part is missing. But I believe we have enough to... So we need 5 out of 18. So we just have enough to do one board up. Which will hopefully give us a little more security. So we're just going to wait out the tired ones. I think we will try and make our three meals. It'd be great if I could get one more meat, but I don't know if it's worth waiting. Fortunately, Marco's improving, though, so... So, I mean... Tempting, but no time to lounge. That sucks. So, yeah. I think everybody's just gonna transition into very hungry. And I'll be right back where I started. But I think I'm gonna hold out for the meat. I hope we'll manage to keep it warm in here. I think it still said that the weather was still summer-like, which is definitely a nice boon. upcoming days should still be nice and warm. So if only I could get some delicious, delicious rat meat, we would actually be in a fairly decent spot. But what a treacherous trip to the toilet. I think we need two more. My guess would be we need two more sort of defenses or sort of repairs. And then probably we should reinforce the door, but I think I'm going to count that as luxury at this point. I'm just showing off how fast Pavel can run. I'm mostly just entertaining myself while I get on to the night. Are you not entertained? Is this not why you are here? Can I get all the doors in time? Sorry, Bruno, fuck you. Success. All right, back to the night. So we're gonna have a pair of guards, scavenger, and we have got a brothel. If you want to get laid for a can of meat, this is the place. Mothers will do some really kinky stuff to get food for their children. It's a big building, well guarded by local thugs. They have plenty of goods and are eager to trade. Warehouse. This used to be the warehouse of a big store. Currently, it's used by a hideout for a group of... used as a hideout by a group of armed thugs. We might find useful things there if we can sneak in, but it is very dangerous. Or we can go to the hotel. Pagoran Travel Agency used to own the small yet luxurious hotel. The owners fled the city just before the siege, along with the foreign journalists who had been staying there. Someone moved in there recently and spread the news that he was willing to barter. Maybe he has something useful to us? So let me just see here. This said caution advised in a city hospital, and I really didn't need to defend myself, so I'm actually going to leave the knife at home this time, but I am going to take the crowbar just in case. Welcome back, Liatu. Once noble and bright, now a shadow of its former self, like us. I mean, the other thing too is if I have a crowbar with me, that is technically a weapon if it has to... Okay, so the game crashes every time I pick up something in the hotel. That's really interesting. All right, let me just take a look at the time. It is later than I thought it was going to be. And I know I got a late start on the cast tonight. I'll be honest with you guys, I am not feeling 100% on going through that day again. I am going to come back to this war of mine, but I would like to do another game in the war series. So I'm going to ask you, leave it to you. Would you like me to surprise you with what the next... game... Ideally, there's going to be a patch for this... by the time I get back to it. But here's a question. We did this last time, which was I gave you a preview as to what the next game would be. That seemed to be very well received. So would you like to see what the next game in our war series is going to be, or would you like to be that a surprise for tomorrow? I am going to go look for somebody to host tonight while we do that.
So Logan doesn't want to see it. Melee Mage does not feel any different. Liatu will wait till next time. Okay, so I think the consensus is to keep it to myself. Oops. All right. Well, with that in mind then, chat, thank you very much for stopping by. I'm sorry to end it so abruptly, but it is almost 1 o'clock for me, and I'm only about 15 minutes off the time that I normally do. So for those of you who are new to the channel, thank you very much for hanging out. I really like this war of mine, and we will be returning to it. We will probably be playing something different tomorrow, but we will come back to this war of mine and hopefully finish that playthrough. Maybe we will get through to the end of the war, maybe not. It's definitely the furthest that I've gotten in the game so far. Now for... Yeah, I think so. We're not 100% done yet. We are a member of Team Panda, who is that's run by a partnered streamer, Seriously Clara, and she is streaming right now, so I would love it if you guys could come along with me for a raid. I'll just put the command inside of chat. Sorry, sadly, the music has to go away when I do that. Clara is a very good friend of mine. I met her in Vancouver at the Twitch meetup, and she has been very helpful in getting me set up on Twitch. I'm also a moderator for her. I'm about as involved as I can be in that community. So if you'd like, feel free to copy and paste that message. We're tired of System Shock, heard this place was better inside of Seriously Clara's channel. I'll probably hang out for a couple of minutes, do a little bit of moderating, and then head off to sleep. I will be back tomorrow. I'll try to be online as close to 7 o'clock Pacific as I can, and we will continue our series of games, of war games. For those of you who can't make it tomorrow, again, thank you very much for stopping by. It was great to have such an audience, and we'll see you next time. Have a good one, guys.